15. Jesus was white, just like his Israelite people. Many people these days wonder what Yahshua or Jesus looked like. In fact, his appearance has become a hotly debated topic these days. You could say somewhat controversial, but it should be a straightforward answer. So logically speaking, he would have to look like any other Adamite, like any descendant of Adam and Eve. And also, since he was of the tribe of Judah, and therefore an Israelite, he would look like any Israelite of the day. But that description works the other way around as well. If we could determine what Christ looked like, then we could determine what all the Israelites looked like, and in turn what all Adamites looked like as well. So let's look at how the Bible describes Christ and the Israelites in general. So the clearest description is in Christ's revelation. Here the Apostle John, now a very old man, likely in his 90s, sees a vision and describes it to us. And right at the start of Revelation, Christ is described as his head and hair. So both his head and hair are white as wool and white as snow. So clearly the color of his head and his hair are white. So what do you think Christ looked like? Many people try to twist that white as wool to somehow meaning the texture of his hair is wool. But that's not what it's saying at all. It's saying it's contrasting the whiteness to as white as wool. The Israelites often use parallelisms where they would describe something twice or multiple times in succession, but from a different perspective, to help explain things. So here the fact it is described twice as white, like wool and like snow, only reinforces that meaning. If it meant texture, then he'd also have the hair like snow and it would melt in the sun. Continuing on, the next verse you need to read it carefully because it describes his feet like fine brass. Now brass is a golden like color, however it says like fine brass, as if having been burnt in a furnace. So in other words, brass at a super hot temperature. Brass goes to a white like color when heated up in a furnace and glows intensely. So that is the allegory John is using here, that Christ's feet are white but glowing. So once again, it's all consistent. He's describing Christ as a white European looking man. But that's not all. There are descriptions of both King David and King Solomon in the scriptures, who were both from the tribe of Judah and therefore in the ancestry of Christ. So logically speaking, whatever they look like, Christ also would have looked like. So starting with King David, there are two descriptions found in the book of Samuel. The first is where Samuel meets David for the first time and describes him as a young, ruddy, handsome youth. Of course, ruddy means to show blood in the face, something only a European looking person could do. It should be noted that many of the most modern translations try to disguise the word ruddy, instead having handsome or good looking, and even absurdly dark. If we do a closer examination of the Hebrew text of that verse, we can clearly see that the word translated to ruddy is Adami. This is a word formed from the root word Adam, another version of the adjective form of Adam, to describe something as red or ruddy. So if it's an object, then it's red, but if it's describing a person, it means ruddy, as in to show blood in the face. So if it means red when describing an object, how can it suddenly change to mean dark when describing a person? Where is the logic in that? The next time David is described is when he meets Goliath, opting to fight him in a duel. Here Goliath looks upon David, and David is once again described as being a young ruddy youth of a fair countenance. Ruddy again means to be showing blood in the face, which to be fair does indicate a healthy looking white person. Interestingly, if we check other translations again, the New Living Translation, which had translated the previous verse we showed as ruddy or Adami as to dark, here in this verse it gets it right suddenly, and this time it translates Adami as ruddy. So which is it, ruddy or dark? And then there is one more verse relating to David, and this is where he is finally anointed and accepted as king over all the children of Israel. So here standing in Hebron, the children of Israel gather and declare they, in relation to David, are thy bone and thy flesh. Now this is a reference to Genesis, where Adam declares that Eve, who was created out of Adam's rib, is the flesh of his flesh and the bone of his bone. In other words, the same race. So in the previous verse, the children of Israel are all declaring that they are the same race and therefore would have a common appearance as David. Now we shall examine the verses about King Solomon. These are even even more explicit than the first descriptions of King David. So we will first turn to the Song of Solomon, and this is read like poetry, so there are a lot of allegories. The first verse is very clear, however. Here Solomon is described as white and ruddy, just like his father David and Christ. Again, we see that white and ruddy go together. A healthy looking white person will have a red undertone to his white skin, signifying good health. Now we should note that the word in Hebrew translated as white is tsak, strong 6703, and is defined as dazzling, glowing, or clear. In this context, when referring to a man or woman, it's clear the intention is white, especially when you see it's combined with ruddy. The word translated as ruddy is simply Adam, so dazzling, glowing, clear, and ruddy, meaning white and ruddy. If we take a look at the Greek Septuagint, this was where the Israelites who translated their Bible into Greek. After the conquests of Alexander the Great around 300 BC, Greek began to become the common lingua de franca, or language of commerce and trade. Therefore, the Israelites decided to translate their entire Bible into Greek as well. So the word sack, which is translated to white in this verse, in the Septuagint was translated to the Greek word leukos, which is white. So the Israelites themselves translated the Hebrew word sack as white. So if certain people try to say it means something else, well, the Israelites themselves are saying it means white. In the next verse, Solomon's head is described as the most fine gold. So basically, he has a golden tan, and this again goes with the dazzling part. He's white, but he's glowing with a tan. Now the next part, his locks are bushy. This could have better been translated as wavy, and then his hair is black as a raven. Hector of Troy was said to have raven dark hair as well. So going through it bit by bit, once again, for Solomon to have a golden head, he would have to be a European looking man to get that golden tan. Now let's actually look at the word translated to bushy. Note that most other translations have wavy hair. Since I'm sticking to the King James version, I stuck with it in this verse as well. So why did all the other translations disagree with the King James? The word translated as wavy or bushy is Tautalim, Strong's 8534. It's an obscure word which is only used once in the Bible. But once again, if we take a look at the Greek Septuagint, how did the Israelites translate this word into Greek? They used vostrikos, which Liddell and Scott define as either a curl or lock of hair, or anything twisted or wreathed. So once again, the Israelites themselves described Solomon as having wavy hair, not bushy hair. As for hair like raven, amongst Europeans it's common to have blonde and brown hair, and perhaps slightly less common to have red hair, but really jet dark black is somewhat unusual, so the verse is making a point of his dark raven hair, which does appear amongst Europeans. You get pale Europeans with blue eyes, yet dark raven hair, and in the sun they get a golden tan, just like Solomon. Moving on, next, his eyes are described like doves by the rivers of water washed with milk. Now, generally, doves are a grey-like colour. Of course, they can be white, but generally grey. So here is contrasting Solomon's eye colour, or irises, to grey, surrounded by milk, or the white part of the eye, the cellera. Next, his cheeks are as a bed of spices, as sweet flowers. This is again implying that ruddiness. He's white with a tan, but has some red color around his cheeks. Sometimes in the tan, white people will get freckles as well, but it's all described in a poetic way. It then goes on to describe his hands and his belly. His hands are described as tanned again, like golden rings, and beryl is a stone that generally reflects a yellow-like color, so the hands are golden and glowing from a tan. Now, as for his belly, it's ivory. Now, this is clear as ivory is always white. The next part, sapphires are blue, so this implies his body is pale with blue veins. So Solomon kept his body covered and it was pale, but his head and hands being exposed to the sun are golden and tanned. Clearly, he was white. In the next verse, his legs are described as pillars of marble. Now, marble is white with blue-like lines, almost looking like veins. So it's a good allegory for a white man in good physical condition who would have blue-like veins appearing through the white skin of his legs, giving them an appearance like marble. The sockets of gold would be a reference to his feet and ankles, or also his lower legs, which would be tanned from the sun. Notice that the parts of his body which were typically exposed to the sun, the feet, ankles, hands and head, are all described as gold. And lastly, the cedars of Lebanon were tall and straight. So again, this tells you Solomon was maybe, perhaps, tall and lean in good physical condition. In fact, overall, it's very common for whites to gain a farmer's tan, where they retain a pale body under their clothing, but their arms and legs that are exposed to the sun become golden. So again, this all perfectly fits the description of any European looking man. Here it should also be noted that Lebanon refers to the mountain range. They were called Lebanon because they were always snowy at the top, so they were white mountains. And if we look at the word Lebanon, Strong's 3844, it will tell us that it's a mountain range. But we can also see that it comes from the root word Laban, which means white. Even just saying the words Lebanon, Laban, you can see the root connection. So let's look at the word Laban, Strong's 3835. So this is the verb form of the word, and it means to be white. Remember, Strong's always split the word into multiple sections. We should also note that Jacob was sent to marry a daughter of Laban, so he was sent to find a daughter of a man whose name means white, whilst Esau married a Canaanite and therefore lost his birthright. We shall cover this more in a later proof. So that is why in a previous verse, Solomon's countenance was compared to Lebanon. His appearance is like a snowy white mountain with a nose like a tower. So that should give a clear description of Solomon, but why don't we see how his wife is described? Solomon married an Egyptian princess. The Egyptians were Mizraim, and at the time of Solomon, around 1000 BC, they were still Adamites and marriage was fine. Of course, 300 years later, by 700 BC, Egypt was overrun by Nubians, and then things changed. Here his bride is described as fair as the moon and as clear as the sun. The word for fair, yupper, means fair or beautiful, or even handsome or pleasant, depending on the context, without any connotation of race or color. However, where the fairness of the bride is compared to the moon and her clarity to the sun, her countenance must be both white like the moon and bright like the sun. So not only was Solomon white, but his wife was white as well, and this also shows that the Egyptians at the time were white. There is another verse later on in Songs of Solomon which is essentially a repeat of what we've already been saying. Here it describes his neck and eyes. So his neck is a tower of ivory, basically a white neck with blue veins, and as for his eyes, they are like fish pools. Generally, pools of water have a blue or grey-like colour. And next, his nose is described as the Tower of Lebanon. A tower is wide at the bottom and thin at the top, so it's implying Solomon has a prominent nose, so a Caucasian nose. Now, we could end it there, but there is one more verse we mentioned in a previous proof, and it is in Lamentations. Now, this book was written by Jeremiah, and it is after the siege of Jerusalem by the Babylonians, and many Israelites were slaughtered, and many suffered severe hardship. So firstly, the Nazarites, which were part of the Israelites, are described as purer than snow, whiter than milk. Another Hebrew parallelism, repeating how white they were. Next, they were more ruddy in body than rubies. Rubies are red, and the word for ruddy here is Adam. So clearly, once again, Adam means red, since they are described as white and ruddy. Next, their polishing was of sapphire. This is talking about the blue veins. So overall, we have white skin like milk, with red undertones, ruddiness, and blue veins underneath. This perfectly describes a white European looking person. Now, usually that verse is hidden or glossed over, and instead all the focus is put on the next verse. Let's have a look. So it says that their visage is black, yes, black, but it's describing dead, withered corpses. When a person dies, the body decomposes and rots. The skin cleaves to the bone and the whole body withers like a stick and often turns black. It's not a pretty sight at all. So if we put both verses together, we see that in their prime, the Gezerites, who were Israelites, were white and ruddy, but after being slaughtered or perishing during the Babylonian siege, they were black rotting corpses lying in the streets. So if we read these verses in proper context, rather than cherry picking one verse containing the word you want, we get the correct picture. Now there's one more verse in Lamentations a little bit later that we should also cover. This is after the siege and the devastation it has caused, and the King James really messed up with this next translation of this verse in Lamentations, where it says, "Our skin was black like an oven due to a terrible famine." Now interestingly, if we check other translations, they say that our skin was hot as an oven, feverish from hunger. Now during sieges, food tends to run out quickly, plagues break out, people are forced to eat anything just to survive, so that their skin would burn with fever is to be expected. So overall, with all of these verses we've covered, such as black as an oven, or that Adam doesn't mean red and ruddy, or that Christ allegedly had woolly hair, or that Solomon didn't have wavy hair, but instead had bushy hair, these are all attempts to make the Israelites into something they were not. And all of these theories rely on poor or incorrect translations. They skew certain words and phrases. They appeal to popular, politically correct ideologies that are not found in the Bible, and above all, they rely on people not taking the time and effort to properly study these verses in depth for themselves. All of these verses, when properly translated and put into correct perspective, paint one clear, consistent picture throughout the entire Bible that the Israelites looked just as white as any modern native Europeans, and anyone trying to change or modify these descriptions is simply lying and deceiving you. Once the light is shone on these lies, they are exposed and the facade crumbles.